SOLIDWORKS Visualize is designed to make it as pain-free as possible to create amazing renders of your product. But even with the most user-friendly program, there are always tools and ways to make things quicker and easier. That's why in this video, I'm going to go through 10 Visualize tips that I believe will make your life easier. The first one is template. When you start a new Visualize project, are you constantly going to the scene to delete that backplate, going to the library and bringing in a scene you are constantly using, creating a camera or two of your standard setups? Well, if this sounds like how you start every single project, then what you need is a new template. This is a project with your default scene, cameras, models, and even appearances and decals all ready for you just to crack on and create your renders. To create a template, simply create a standard project or even use the one that you already have before. Delete the model and any associated appearances. Save this somewhere sensible. And in your Tools, Options, General, select Use Current Project as Default. Every time you select New or Import a New Model, this template will be copied and you're ready to go. My second tip is a few options to do with setting up your user interface. Now this one is more for if you have just installed Visualize, but I constantly see people still using the absolute default interface like this. And although it is still good, there are definitely some things I always do that make things a little easier. First, and most obviously, is the viewport size. This is default to fairly small, which means you have a lot of dead space around it. However, if you have a dedicated graphics card, there is no point having a viewport this small, and it will run just as well when it is a larger size. To change this, head to Tools, Options, 3D Viewport, Maximum Resolution. Using the drop-down, set it to Fill Window. This will fill up any space that the other elements don't take up. My second piece of advice regarding the user interface would be to drag out the palette so you get two columns. You can also select the change layout option. Having two columns available just means you have to scroll less to find the options. If you have a lot of data, it can also be worth using the next icon and changing the viewing type, very much like you would in Windows Explorer. My last piece of advice would be to turn off any parts of the software that you don't use. For example, if you have Visualize Professional, the timeline might automatically be visible. However, for some projects, you might not be using it. So head to View and select it to turn it off. As well as turning them off, the heads up display and the HUD can also be unpinned so they only appear when hovering close by. My third tip is render layers in the viewport. Now you may have seen render layers before in the output tools quality section. These are great at outputting multiple renders such as this beauty and clown layer, so that editing in Photoshop becomes easier. However, not many people know that you can also view these in the viewport. Head to View, Viewport Settings, and a dialog box will appear, with the bottom drop-down being our render layers. You have to be in accurate modes for these to show, but what I often use these for is when I have imported a model with no appearances on. Especially if all the parts are touching, it is nearly impossible to know what and where the part is. For this, I use the clown layer, which adds a different colour onto each object. I can then easily see, select, add appearance, or animate each individual part. It is also worth noting that because this is an accurate mode, it will try doing a number of passes pointlessly. Therefore, it can be worth just setting the viewport number passes to 1 to increase the speed. These viewport settings can also be useful simply for viewing what you are actually going to output before rendering. Now my fourth tip, focus the camera, is very quick but very useful, especially if you have larger models but are just working on certain areas of it. Take this project where I have animated these trainers. The last trainer has yet to be animated and needs work. However, when zoomed in on and rotated, the camera is rotating around a point off the screen, so it is very hard to work with the required shoe. To fix this, choose whether you want to focus on the model, group, part, or appearance you select on using the selection tools, and then hold down Shift, Alt, and right click on what you want the camera to focus on. When rotating, you can see now I am rotating around the correct shoe. Slightly different to this is the lookup function in the heads-up display. That modifies both the focal point and the camera position. However, it gets you the same effect, and you can use the shortcut Shift, Control, Left click for this tool. This brings me nicely on to keyboard shortcuts. There are many default ones that can really speed things up, such as G to move, E to scale, R to rotate, K to add keyframes. There are hundreds that I use every day, so check out tools, keyboard shortcuts to see them all, as well as change or export them. Back on this last trainer, I want to snap it to the top of the block here. To do this, I could spend a while trying to line it up by eye, or I could use the snapping tool. This tool snaps the pivot point of one object to the surface of another. The first thing I must do is move the pivot point of the trainer to the bottom. To do this, I make sure the pivot starts in the center of the part using the transform tools, and then I open the pivot tool from the heads-up display. If I hold Control down and drag, I can snap the pivot point to the center of the bottom instead. Then I can move back to the translation tool, right click on the green square, and I drag that to the top of the block. Yeah. This will then jump the trainer onto the block surface that I hover over. My next tip is to get objects to follow each other. In this case, the cube needs to follow the shoe when I move it. This tool can be found in the Transform tab of the models, but also in the Transform tab of cameras, and can be extremely helpful to reduce workload, as it means you have to animate less things. For example, I will make the shoe go up and down. Rather than having to try and make the cube go up and down the same amount, I will just tell the cube to follow the shoe, meaning I don't have to do anything really to the cube. Copy animations. Now you have seen I have started this animation already by making the first 5 shoes go up and down. Instead of having to add 5 or 6 keyframes to this last one, I will simply copy the animations. To do this, I drag the animation from the timeline into the graphics area onto the model that I want to copy it to. This will copy the animation in exactly the same place, but won't copy any keyframe properties such as motion ease. These can be copied individually by right-clicking the keyframe and selecting Copy Settings, and then right-clicking and Paste Settings. The whole animation can then simply be dragged across to make it happen after the previous one. Cleaning your project out. Everything such as appearances, environments, and cameras that you have previously used are saved with one Visualize project. This is useful for data management, but projects can also get fairly big. Bigger projects take longer to save, but it can also take longer to render. So before saving or rendering it, it is worth having a clean out. The project cleaner can help with this. To initiate it, select Project, Delete All Unused Items. Select what categories you want it to consider, and then press Analyze. This will show you anything you are not currently using, and you have the option to untick if you want to keep it. You can then click Clean, and everything still ticked will be deleted. My last tip is the render profiles. In recent versions, this was upgraded to become the center of the Render Wizard interface. What it means is if you have settings you are constantly inputting, you can have these saved ready to go every time you go to the Render Wizard. For example, for this animation, I'm going to create a new profile and call it YouTube with Post. For the animation type, I will select Image Sequence and select Save Profile. I will select TIFF and Save Profile. I won't change the size, so I don't need to save anything here. And I will then set the render passes to 1000 and turn denoiser on, and again, save this profile. When I next go to the output tools, in this or any other project, this render profile will be selectable, so I don't have to bother inputting all these values again. I can even lock it so I don't accidentally change anything.